Another key question that comes up in relationship to the Gospels is the issue of oral tradition. The way this is portrayed in Jesus Interrupted is that someone told someone a story about Jesus who told us the same story about Jesus who told the same story about Jesus. And it might be 19 or 20 people removed from the actual source. And like the old game, the telephone book, you know, the story that you get at the end is not at all like the story you get at the beginning. And I actually think we know a lot more about the oral tradition and the way in which it was controlled in the way it was communicated within the church than that model suggests. And let me give you a couple of examples to work with. I once was in a debate with John Dominic Crossan, certainly one of the better known historical Jesus scholars in the United States. We had a conference on memory at SMU. And he raised the issue of oral tradition and memory this way. He said, let's assume that oral tradition does work reasonably well, but let's ask the question about whether memory actually works well. And he used this example. At Emory University, when the Challenger exploded, this was the space shuttle explosion with the teacher in it back in the 80s, said that Emory University took a group of freshmen and asked them where they were when the Challenger exploded and how they heard about it, wrote down their answers, and dismissed the students. Thank you very much for helping us with our survey. 3 years later, they invited them back, I think on the premise that they were seniors, although I bet probably some of them were juniors, and asked them the question again, where were you when the Challenger exploded and how did you hear about it? Recorded their answers and then compared their later answers with their earlier answers and then represented the two answers to the students and asked the students which one did they prefer. And generally speaking, the students preferred the answer they gave most recently to the older answer. And Crossan used this as an example to argue that memory plays tricks on us, and what we remember originally and what we experience originally is not the way we remember it later. That was the point that he was making that he said came out of this study. I was asked to respond to this in rebuttal, which I did, and I raised the question this way. I said, the assumption of the study made at Emory is to simply pick students at random who have no connection to NASA, are never going to ride a space shuttle, have nothing at stake in the memory. I said, I wonder what would happen if you gave that same survey to NASA astronauts who one day might have to crawl into that space shuttle and actually ride that ship into space. I said, my suspicion is that with something at stake, the nature and the care given to the memory would change because there was something invested in remembering this. It wasn't just a random tragedy that you were trying to recall, even though it was a traumatic one. And so I think that analogy works with Jesus because with Jesus we have a specific figure who has impacted the lives of the people that we're talking about who are sharing about that. So that's one feature and one example. The second thing that makes oral tradition an important discussion is the role of the apostles themselves. If you remember in Acts chapter 1, when Judas is being replaced, the requirement for his replacement is that he had to be with the ministry from the beginning. And the reason is that the apostles had a role in overseeing this tradition. In fact, Luke refers to those who orally reported the tradition in the churches as those who are eyewitnesses and ministers of the word from the beginning. So this role of the apostles exercises a control in how this material is being passed on from church to church. And my third example to talk about this actually is my own grandson. My own grandson, when I tell him or read him a story, and babysitters will know this as well as grandparents, as well as parents. If I read a story to my child and I change that story significantly, that child who lives in an oral world, my grandchildren don't read yet, who lives in an oral world, processes everything orally by what he hears, will tell me that's not the story. He'll correct me because he knows the story well enough to know how it ought to be told. That's how tradition worked within the church in that kind of a way. Now, a fourth point with regard to oral tradition is to actually look at the gospel traditions themselves, which show that although details do vary as you tell some of these stories, the gist of these stories is basically the same where we get parallels. And that tells you the quality of the oral tradition is not to radically alter those stories. It may be to paint the details slightly differently, or it may be to tell the story slightly differently to bring out another nuance in the story, but it's not to radically change the gist of the story. All these features tell us that the kind of oral tradition we're dealing with in the Gospels is a carefully overseen kind of oral tradition. It isn't memorized, it's not that tight, but neither is it as free and wild as the telephone book story suggests.